Welcome back to The Ancient Path. Let's take one more look at how we can participate with God in changing the future. Oftentimes, when God calls us to follow after Him, it's like Abraham. It's leaving familiarity behind. It's leaving behind things that we're comfortable with, and leaving behind what we might or what might have been popular opinion or the usual way of doing life. With that in mind, I want to consider how pervasive the thought of an unchangeable future is, frankly, to Christian culture. We say cute but unbiblical phrases like God's in control or everything happens for a reason. And there is this sense that whatever happens is because God is controlling it to happen for some predetermined reason that He has and that we often know nothing about. I want to say this. That is Christian fatalism. Fatalism is the belief that somehow, no matter what I do, ultimately, whatever is going to happen is going to happen. This is Christian fatalism. Fatalism is the belief that somehow, no matter what I do, ultimately, whatever is going to happen in the future has already been established, and therefore my decisions will not change that predetermined future. It's a belief that really, no matter what decisions I make, fate, aka God being in control, will ultimately bring about whatever outcome results from my decisions. This is problematic for several reasons. Firstly, it minimizes my personal responsibility over the choices I make, because I don't think that they matter that much in the grand scheme of things. Secondly, it minimizes the need to really develop a strong relationship with God, because I'm just trying to get to heaven, not actually partnering with God to bring heaven here. Perhaps the most prominent reason God gave us free will is He wants a relational universe. And thirdly, maybe worst of all, it blames God for things that are not His fault. A friend was killed in a car accident because of a drunk driver who crossed the yellow line. Then you hear phrases like, God's in control. Everything happens for a reason. That's terrible theology. Your friend died in a car wreck for a reason, and the reason is that the other guy was in sin. He was drunk and behind the wheel. That wasn't God's will, and it deeply, I think, grieves the heart of God. Think about it like this. John Wesley, 200 years ago, was an Englishman. He was an Englishman at a time when slave trade was a strong part of the English economy. He was an Englishman who spoke powerfully against slavery. He denounced it and called for it to be abolished. He prayed for and encouraged William Wilberforce, the man who would ultimately end slave trade in England. Wesley's views were not popular, but they were holy. They honored God. And eventually, they were proven right. On the other hand, think about the effect of people's choices to reject the truth that all men and women are made in the image of God. What did the decisions to reject that truth do? It set us on a course for deep racial division, which has lasted well over 200 years. How would the world look different if in Wesley's generation, the people had repented? Would racism between whites and blacks even exist? Perhaps not. Certainly, there is enough blame to go around for any generation. But in some ways, our world is suffering because of the sinful choices of previous generations. Don't hear what I'm not saying. We definitely suffer for our own sinfulness too. The point I'm trying to make is that when we reject the grace of God, when we reject the grace to obey Him, it doesn't just cost us dearly, it also negatively affects generations beyond us. The kingdom of God is a family business where God's people partner with God to bring about a better future. So with that in mind, I want to ask you, what do you want the world to look like in 200 years? Are you allowing the Spirit of God to direct you? Do you believe that God will use your decisions to affect the world around you? Do you believe that this God-human partnership, that through this God-human partnership, things could actually change, that God will create a world that reflects His glory and His goodness? If you believe this, are you making space in your daily and weekly schedule to read the Scripture and to listen for God's voice in prayer? Like Wesley, Scripture and prayer enables us to be a people who stand outside of the cultural fallenness of our day and of our time and partner with God in the kingdom that He is bringing forth on the earth. Be blessed.